Well, hello, church. I hope everyone is doing very well. My name is Jeff Claybaugh. I am associate pastor at Pine Valley Community Church, and we'd just like to thank you for joining us today. Thank you for taking part in our Church at Home series. We've been doing this for just over a month now, and you may have watched some of our previous videos, and you may have wondered if my family still had our tent, our fort up that we put up in our living room a little more than a month ago, and we do. As you can see, it is still here, covers our whole living room. We've had a lot of fun in here over the last several weeks. I pray that these services have blessed you, that they have been something where you have been able to see that even in a difficult time like the one that we're in right now, there is still hope, and that is hope that can only be found in Jesus. Because we want to be a church that proclaims hope in this time, but really in any time, because we know that God is in control, we know that He is a God of hope, and we know that we can trust in Him. We also want to recognize today that all over the world, all over our nation, there are people that are out there on the front lines in many different ways. Many essential workers are putting their lives on the line every single day. Many are doing vital work that is saving lives. And even other essential workers, though they may not feel like they're right there on the front lines, or they may not feel like they're saving lives or even risking their own lives, I would say that many of them are still doing critical work for the rest of the population. The ones that are maybe keeping certain that some parts of our economy continue to move, maybe those that are developing new and creative ways to communicate. Maybe those being responsible for just sending out news, sending out information to the world. So before we begin our service today, I'd like to lead us in a prayer that we can all pray together. This prayer comes from a ministry called Flourish San Diego, and this is a ministry that Pastor Joe and I have been a part of for a few months, and we are so glad to be. This prayer is intended to be a responsive reading. And so that means that there's a leader, which would be me, and there's a congregation, which is you. And you are supposed to read the bold words that are written in this prayer and read those along with me as I go through the prayer. I hope that you could take part in this out loud from your home or wherever you are. And I pray that it'll be just by the Holy Spirit, it'll be some sense of unity that we feel together as we go through this prayer. So let's pray. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Father of all the world, we come to you on behalf of others who are not able at this time to self-quarantine because their services are needed. We pray for you to guard them, to guide them, to give them the wisdom to know if and when they are sick and to stay home. When they are at work, we pray for safety, good humor, and peace as they perform their duties faithfully. Bless them, O Lord. For medical technicians, aides, hospital administrators and workers, urgent care workers, cleaning and laundry staff, food service staff, doctors, nurses, surgeons, drugstore employees, pharmacists. Lord, hear our prayer. For police, guards, firemen and women, emergency workers, life flight and ambulance drivers, armed servicemen and women here and abroad, prisoners, prison guards and administrators, judges, defendants, and lawyers who are still in court. Bless them, O Lord. For postal workers, bankers, and government employees and administrators at all levels. Lord, hear our prayer. For veterinarians and assistants, pet supply store employees, pet sitters and walkers. Bless them, O Lord. For child caregivers, clergy, parents, and those who have to go out to get supplies, morticians, dentists, mental health workers. Lord, hear our prayer. For farmers, migrant workers, food handlers, food supply chain workers, grocery store employees, gas station and convenience store workers, car service workers, restaurant workers, truck drivers, hotel workers. Bless them, O Lord. For radio and TV journalists, newscasters, and weathermen and women. Lord, hear our prayer. For repairmen of various types, plumbers, telecommunications workers, furnace repairmen, car service workers. Bless them, O Lord. For the aged, poor, homeless, migrants in holding, and those who work with the underserved, those without health care or access, and those who live alone. Lord, hear our prayer. For students who are without food, without a caregiver in the home, without learning environments, behavioral parameters, social interactions, and all benefits normally provided by school. Bless them, O Lord. For all essential workers who are still needed to serve the public when many others close, for those who cannot work because their business is closed and fear the financial repercussions, for all who are worried for lack of money if they cannot work or face the possibility of infection if they do, bless them and protect them all, O Lord. Remind us to be mindful and thankful, Holy Spirit. Father, we confess that we don't realize how often these people and others serve us on a daily basis. We confess our lack of awareness and lack of gratitude. Many are not paid a livable wage or certainly not paid enough for the often truly thankless service that they provide, let alone the risk to their own health during a pandemic. We are sorry, Lord, and we ask that your Spirit reminds us of their humble duties and to be grateful and thankful. Help us to acknowledge them personally and often. Help these workers also to acknowledge themselves and to hear you say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." We pray for protection, safety, resilience, health, peace of mind and heart, and restoration of all that they gave up, did without, or couldn't get for themselves. Amen. Thanks again to all of you. Michaela Aragon, someone who happens to be in the educational sector, someone we just prayed for, will be leading our music today. Hope to see you all soon.
Good morning, Pine Valley Community Church. As we begin to worship our Lord, I wanted to share something with you that was on my heart. This week has been particularly tough given my sleep schedule being all messed up from not having really anything to go to or be at. And so starting this week back up with Zoom classes for work has been challenging. And I found myself very cranky and very heavy-hearted and heavy-burdened. And so while I was trying to come up with a set this week and trying to figure out what I was going to play and what I was going to sing, I couldn't do anything. I was too cranky and too hard heavy that nothing was sounding right. Nothing was looking right. I didn't want to play. I was frustrated. I was tired. And so just through all that, God reminded me that He is constant. His love is unfailing. He is able to work through my stuff inside of me. And yeah, and so a scripture that came up this week was Psalm 73, verse 26. And it says, "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." And that's just encouraging to me, because regardless of everything that's going on in my life, there is one thing that stays the same, one thing that doesn't fail, and it is God. And so I hope that encourages you as you continue to make strides in this time of chaos. So if you would just worship with me and sing along or sing in your hearts and just give praises to our God.
Thank you.
Lord. You are able to finish the work that you've started in us, Lord. That you don't rely on ourselves to finish our faith and to work our faith out on our own, but you work it out with us, and through your Son, we are able to have that relationship with you, and that you care so much for us. Lord, we praise you for that. He is jealous of me.
if there's any way, because the answer lies in you. They laid to rest before, they've known just what to do. Their souls are lost because they could never find what's this life for. What's this life for? What's this life?
Well, that question has been asked trillions and trillions of times throughout the history of the world by every language and every tongue in every place in the world. Well, good morning. Welcome to our time of worship together in the Spirit of God as we are gathered together in His Spirit and excited about this time of worship in God's Word today. And I would ask that you would take out your notes. If you haven't downloaded them, that you would download them, have them, or however it is that you get those to be able to fill them in, be able to write in them today. Well, now, years ago, there was a renowned philosopher who was held in great regard by his driver. He had this driver that drove him around everywhere, and that driver went with him and listened to his lectures as he answered difficult questions on the meaning of life. And after attentively listening for years to the lectures of this famous philosopher, one day the driver just kind of popped this question and he asked, hey, what about switching roles one evening? I've been listening to you all this time and you want to do this? And the philosopher agreed. He thought, hey, this will be fun. So for a while on that evening, the driver handled himself remarkably well with the lecture. However, when the time for questions came, there was a person in the back of the room that asked, well, is the epistemological meta-narrative that you seem to espouse compatible with the teleological account of the universe? He replied, well, that is an extremely simple question. Even my driver can answer that. Well, when it comes to the meaning of life, things don't seem that simple, especially on a experiential level. And with COVID-19, this is a difficult time because of the threat of death, because of being out of work or being cooped up and detained and delayed from going on with life and living life as usual. And there is a concern that alcohol and drug problems are going to be increased over the years that follow as a result, because people are struggling to cope. Studies with Hurricane Katrina showed that there was a 35% increase in addictive social problems in the years that followed the hurricane. I heard the other day that the sales of alcohol is up 40%. I imagine there's probably something like that with drugs as well, and I heard that as well with the pornography. There is an unprecedented experience that we're having right now with COVID-19, bringing people to the edge of coping and the question of meaning. And the reality is, to live a wise, effective, significant, healthy, credible, meaningful life, we should all be living in light of the meaning of life all the time. Now today we're going to answer the questions, or we're going to look at this. We're going to look to see that the God of the Bible gives an astounding answer to what it means to be human. And if you have your notes, I'd like you to just look at them at that there at the top for a minute. The Bible's answer is vastly different than the answer to that question of meaning back in the time that the Bible was written. And the Bible's answer is also vastly different than the answer that we receive in our cultures today. And there is a reason that young people are sexting and sending naked pictures of themselves to one another, and why children are cutters and self-harmers and self-haters, why kids do crazy things to get attention, why our Western culture is marked by celebrityism. There's a reason why Gen Zers were going around coughing everywhere and licking toilet seats and such like that when the COVID-19 restrictions came out. There is a reason why there is child depression and adult depression and frustration and fear and anger and emptiness and aimlessness. We will get into that another time, but now let's look at what the Bible says about what it means to be human. Now, last Sunday we began to ask the question, what is the home and the family for? And it is important to know our purpose in parenting. And to do that, we're going to go back to beginning, to where we get our foundation. So I'd ask you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis 1. We're going to be there, Genesis 1, 26 this morning. And the Bible gives a multifaceted answer. Today we're going to see, and again, there's a place in your notes where you can fill this in. We're going to see that the home and the family exist to cultivate kings and queens who animate or embody the presence of the Lord in all of life. And that's a big deal. I'd ask you to circle that or draw a box around that or do something with that. And that may sound a little strange, but let's begin in reading in verse 26. And before we do, we want to get a little perspective. And if you printed out your notes, there's a place that you can write some things in there. Now, Genesis 1, chapter 1, is giving the broad brush strokes of creation. And biblical writers gave space and time and breadth to the most important parts of their stories. Now, up until this point, the first 5 days of creation, there's been a carefully measured amount of words that have been used. But now when we come to the sixth day, it stretches out for nearly the same length as the first 5 days altogether. And this is the, we could say, the climax of creation. Now, in your Bible also, as you're looking at that, you should have verse 27 that is broken out between verse 26 and 28. This is highlighting that this is Hebrew poetry. Now, inserting poetry into the narrative was a common Hebrew writing technique that was in the scriptures, and it was to draw your attention to something that was important. And poetry is inserted into the narrative to give insight and understanding and perspective for what's actually taking place in the story. And it was always something important. It's like saying, hey, pay attention to this. And so we have poetry in verse 27 that is sandwiched in between verse 26 and 28. Now in verse 26 and 28, they give what we could call parallel insights. They talk about the same things, or they restate what's taking place. And this again is a Hebrew writing technique to draw attention to what is important. Now in addition to that, in verse 26 and 28, there is this double mention of the animal kingdom. And then there is this quadruple repetition that humans are created in the image of God. See, 4 times we're told that humans are created in the image or the likeness of God. So clearly we're to pick this up. So now let's read verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. And they will rule the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky, the livestock, all the earth and the creatures that crawl on the earth. And now here's the poetry. So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female. And then verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and every creature that crawls on the earth. There's an emphasis here that is clear. And again, there's a place in your notes you can write in. God created humanity in his image. But what exactly does it mean to be created in the image of God? Generations of readers have offered insight, but the text itself, in context, should determine what that statement means. And it does. Human beings are created to be rulers. The Lord says that, verse 26, 28, rule. Now, this is king language, rule. This is humanity's original glory. See, why is it that so many cultures in literature, in art, in film are about princes and princesses, kings and queens? And usually it's the same story over and over. Usually there's a child in obscurity or oppression or poverty like Cinderella that is somehow blessed and becomes royalty. Or some promised child of hope is born and who against all odds finally becomes king. And that story resonates with us all. I mean, why do we have games called Kingdom or Game of Thrones? That's because of our original purpose and glory. We were made to be rulers. Now, most people have no clue what they were created for. There is a total disconnect between purpose and creation. And what the Bible is saying is vastly different than the purpose of humanity today. And it's vastly different than the purpose of humanity also in the ancient world. Now, the scriptures were not written in a vacuum. They were written into time and space in the ancient Near East. And Genesis wasn't the only creation story. There were others. Here's a line from one of the most popular. It's called the Enuma Elish. It's from came from Babylon, the area that we call Mesopotamia. The language there is the closest in affinity with biblical Hebrew. This is the area where Abraham was called from, and it was a cultural epicenter in antiquity. And it says, I will establish a savage. Man shall be his name. He will be charged with the service of the gods that they might be at ease. Now, most of the creation stories from around this time, they all have the same basic idea. The gods are tired. They are worn out. They don't have anybody to worship them. So the humans are created, and usually through some kind of bloody battle in some way. And the humans are created to be cheap slave labor and worshipers of the gods, in order to bring them food and drink, to do their work for them, to fight their wars for them. And in these other cultures, there was also a human. One human who was created in the image of a god, in the image of the god of that nation, whatever nation it was. There was one human who was in the image of the god, and that one human was the king of the land. Now, that's a pretty good gig for a king. And both of the Egyptians and Babylonian kings back in the day were called the image of God. In fact, Ramses means son of Re. That was the main god in their pantheon. Now, because the king was God's image in the world, that also meant that he was the rightful ruler in power. And he set up images and statues of himself all around to remind folks, hey, this is who's in charge, me. Now, we actually still see this in communist and dictatorial and totalitarian countries today. That's still going on in North Korea today, all over the place. And this was in Russia with Lenin. We saw in Iraq with the statue of Saddam Hussein that was brought down in the Gulf War. It's a pretty popular picture right there. And then now, as we still see today, that setup was great for the king, but bad news for everyone else. You see, there is a dark underbelly to that way of living. If there is just one king and he alone is the image of God, then that means the rest of us aren't. And that was the ancient worldview. See, that meant that all the rest of the human beings were expendable. They were cheap slave labor. They were to be used and thrown away. And that is the way the world functioned back then and still does in some places, many places today. But now we are coming to something absolutely astounding. This is incredible. Read over and against the other creation stories of the day, Genesis is completely shocking. Really is. See, the story of the world opens up with God Himself working to create a world which is His home, and His home which is a place for Him to be with humanity, a place for us to experience His joy and His presence and His blessing with us. And people are not created to be some kind of cheap slave labor, but rather co-rulers, co-creators, the family of God that are with Him, with His home, in His home, with Him as partners in ruling the rest of creation. That's a vast difference. And when we read the bookends on this sandwich that we are looking at, it becomes clear that human beings are responsible for the totality of creation. Let's just look again at verse 26 and verse 28. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, all the earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. Verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and every creature that crawls on the earth. If you want to turn the page, there's a place we can write in there. And as kings and queens, we were to do two things. And we just want to highlight those right now. People were made to, first of all, A, have children and raise them to be kings and queens. And then for their descendants to spread out and fill the earth as kings and queens. Now listen. This is the parent's job in the biblical sense and worldview and culture to unfold and develop and do the hard work and the full-time job of raising children. Future generations of kings and queens who will spread out over the whole earth and fill it as imagers or images of God. That is our biblical purpose. And I'd love for us to connect this with our vision from Isaiah 44 that God personally gave us at Pine Valley Community Church in regard to raising up descendants. And we have this around the building. It'd be great when we get back in there. Raising up future generations of both physical and spiritual descendants who will be strong, bold, and fruitful in the love and mission of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that raising up of kings and queens is what is called the cultural mandate. Because this is a command to create culture, to create civilization, and to spread it out all over the world. Do you see that? Humanity is created in the image of God, kings and queens, to spread the image of God over the whole world. Now, this is every human being's job description. This is our vocation. And the first way that we do that is parenting. The art, science, hard work of unfolding children who will be kings and queens. Just think about this. God could have made kings and queens from the dust just as he did with Adam. But he chose to work through marriage, the home, the family, a man and a woman and their children, and then their generations. And God gave the first humans the privilege of starting civilization from scratch. That's pretty cool, huh? Now, secondly, people were made to rule over all creation. Now, human beings were not intended to rule one another, and that seems pretty obvious sometimes with the awful job that humans often and sometimes tend to do in ruling others. But we were intended to rule creation. Every human being was intended to rule creation all over the world. Now, that word rule can be translated reign or have dominion. And again, this is king language. John Mark Comer writes that one Hebrew scholar translated this to actively partner with God in taking the world somewhere. Andy Crouch writes that it is making something of the world. And in fact, there's a place in your notes, this is significant to get, I'd like us to write it in there. It says, to rule, to make something of the world, to actively partner in taking the world somewhere. In other words, God created human beings to be partners with him in developing culture, civilization, history, writing the story of the world. And what's clear from verse 26 and 28 is that that is the totality of creation. And God begins with the first kings and queens in the garden, but they are to take this garden out to the rest of the world. They are to move the garden out and establish it and grow it in the rest of creation. They are to develop it and lead it and cause it to flourish. I have this in your notes as well, verse 28. The first humans are blessed, they are blessed by God to produce a family and to extend their family of kings and queens to fill the earth. And then in filling the earth, they are to subdue it. Now that word subdue is interesting. It's the Hebrew word kibosh, and some people think that's where we get to saying, hey, put the kibosh on it. It has a range of meaning. And in the scripture, most often has this idea of overcoming an enemy, overcoming something hostile to you. But it also can mean bringing order out of chaos or to bring harmony out of discord. And it can mean to tame something that is wild. And that seems to be the sense of it here. Again, in your notes, there's a place to just circle this or notice this, that human beings had a big job to do in a teeming, wild, raw, boundless, and flowing creation. If you turn to chapter 2, let's read verse 10 through 15. A river went out from Eden to water the garden. From there it divided and became the source of four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon, which flows from the entire land of Havilah, where there is gold. Gold from that land is pure. Delum and onyx are also there. The name of the second river is Gihon, which flows through the entire land of Cush. The name of the third river is the Tigris, which runs east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. Now, what we're reading about here, these are raw materials. And then there is this garden to be cultivated and to work and to be watched over. And there are rivers that provide the needs of culture. And there is teeming life that's described in chapter 1 that is living in them that needs to be harnessed. And there are gold and minerals to be mined that are to be shaped to be useful and beautiful and valuable items. And here is the sense. You have rivers. Make them work for you to extend civilization and to bless other parts of creation. There are forests that are filled with trees. Do something with them. There are minerals and land and sun and wind and soil and rain. There are plants of all kinds. figure out how to use them. You have a world filled with teeming creatures of all kinds. Harness them, direct them, bless them, use them for good purposes, and make music, create art, build homes, research the world, order creation, and make it fruitful. So let's pull this together. In the text, in Genesis 1 and 2, we see what it means to be made in the image of God. And in fact, there's a place in your notes. I'd love for you to circle this, because this is important. We see that God is creator, that he is worker, that is, he is a ruler who blesses. The Lord God creates. God rules. God works. He blesses. In 6 days, he did the work of creating his home and then moving into it, and with the humans in the center of it with them, and they are partners and co-rulers and co-workers who had the significant privilege and, in fact, the glory of developing civilization and writing the story of the world. You see, God placed it, what we're reading about, God placed it into their hands, and it's like, here you go. Have fun, and I'll be with you with it. Yeah, let's go. Now, the word image can be translated idol or statue. In fact, most people don't know this, but it is the same word that in the rest of the Bible is translated idol. And again, there's a place you can write that in your notes. And that may surprise some of you. I mean, what is up with that? Well, we think of an idol as the visible representation of an invisible spiritual being. But idols were actually much more than that. Idols were understood to embody the presence of the God that they were the image of. In fact, there's a place in your notes that you can write that. In other words, an idol animated or came to life with the presence of the God that was being called on. Now, there is a similar picture here, but we are not wood or stone. We're the real deal. We are living idols. And again, there's a place that you can write in your notes. We are living, breathing idols filled with the life and the presence and the wisdom and the goodness and the works of God. Now, that's not a diminishing picture. It is a powerful picture of kings and queens and rulers. And humanity was to be the very presence of God all over the earth, carrying out his work in creating, ruling, ordering, developing, forming civilization in the culture of the world. And God is a worker. God is a creator. God is a ruler who blesses and who blessed humanity to rule the world in his presence with them, as his image and in his likeness, as co-creators, co-workers, co-rulers, to make this boundless creation organized and harnessed and developed and beautiful and fruitful, to help it and to cause it to flourish in his blessing. And humanity was to fill the rest of creation with harmony and discovery and art and writing and culture and government and engineering and systems and exploration and civilization. God gave the first humans the privilege of starting civilization from scratch. And from the beginning, God's intent for humanity is to be partners with him in his work, co-workers. That is what we were made for. That is our purpose, and that is a big purpose. So what does this mean for us and for our children and for our grandchildren? It's fine to talk about kings and queens, and we don't live in the ancient Near East, and we're not royalty. What does this mean for cleaning services and full-time moms and a server at the restaurant when things get going again? insurance salesmen and physical therapists and sheriff and a port of entry officers and border patrol and sheet metal worker and an engineer and a manager and a teacher, high school student, a nanny, real estate agent, doctor, nurse, construction worker, a cook, a homemaker. Well, a lot. It means a whole lot. And for parents who are raising children, it means a lot. For starters, it means that work is a core part of being human. And so today, wherever you are, whatever you do in your work, you are there to make something of it, to actively partner with God in taking it somewhere, taking the world somewhere, on God's behalf, with His presence with you. A living idol. Now, in light of this revelation, let's think about what it is that our children and future generations need to know about their purpose and how God can work through us as parents and mentors to unfold our physical and spiritual descendants to be kings and queens. So we're going to look at, in fact, if you turn to your last page, we're going to look at four need-to-know truths for being kings and queens who are God's living idols embodying or animating His presence. First of all, number one is that work is good. Now, you may not feel that way. You may hate your job. You may view work as a curse. Hey, this is a curse. And work is cursed, but it is not itself a curse. In fact, it's the opposite. All of life, just think about it, all of life involves work. And work is a blessing. We read, God blessed them and said, be fruitful, fill the earth, rule it, subdue it. Now, a blessing in scriptures is a great thing. It's a heavy thing. It's a weighty thing. It's a good thing. It's a gift of God. And this flies in the face of a lot of the thinking of our cultures of youth or young adults today, doesn't it? That life is about traveling around the world and having adventures and being in adolescence as long as you can. Staying a child, doing childish things, staying away from responsibility as long as you can, staying away from the new verb in our vocabulary, adulting, doing adult things or acting like adults as long as you can. Well, the opposite is true. Children should grow up working and learning to work because work is good. And it feels good. It feels good to work. I remember being 5 or 6 years old and working alongside my dad in the yard, and I really wonder if I was much help at all, but I do remember feeling so good and so proud to be working alongside my dad. Work is good. And God has a work for each one of us to do, a calling, a vocation, where we contribute to others in society. A second need to know is that God wants a kingdom that is flourishing. God wants a kingdom that is flourishing with goodness and fertility and prosperity and joy and beauty and order and life. Just read the Psalms, the prophets, the promises about the new world that God is restoring. That's how it's pictured. Read about the new heavens and earth in the book of Revelation. You see, that is the kingdom that God is starting to remake now, right now, through us. And as God's co-worker and co-creator and co-ruler, you're going to be called in this present age to stand against some things. That's one reason I'm proud of Don and Marcia Anima. And if you know them, they get it. They get it. That in this present age, there are some lies and injustice that we're to stand against. And then to create new possibilities, new understanding, new ways of thinking, new ways of doing things. You see, part of humanity's work was to subdue creation. They were in the garden but they were to extend the garden to the rest of creation. That meant to make something of the world, to partner with God in taking the world somewhere. How do you do that in your workplace or at home in your story? How do you do that? Well, we're going to talk more about that in the future, but you might start by asking the Lord that now in your life. Ask him that question and then listen to what he says. Listen to what he points you to. Listen, look at what he does in your circumstances. And then a third need to know is that work is a way you serve and worship God. Part of the sense and the meaning of the word work is to serve and to worship. And that is what work is. In a way, we serve and worship God and follow him in his mandate is that we work. Now, I don't know how much our kids remember this, but from an early age, they worked, and it was a means of serving and worshiping God. We talked about it. And they pulled weeds at the church building, and they helped on church work days, and that was there was a sense of belonging and significance and capability that they developed through that. They worked at home and things that we needed to do as a family and what needed to be done around where we lived. And we lived in an area where most folks heated with wood stoves. And they would help widows stack firewood or clean pine needles off the roofs or go and visit and care about others. And that's a part of work, just relational caring, loving others. Studies show that people who serve others are the happiest people. And people who serve God by serving others live lives of significance and meaning. Children need to learn that when they're young. They need to learn that in their teen years. And then a fourth need to know is that life is sacred. Now, something that we've started to say around here, and we're going to continue to say this on into the future, is that all of life is all for Jesus. That is how life is meant to be lived. And that means that there is no secular and sacred distinction. That means that what Pastor Jeff and Pastor Joe do isn't more spiritual than all the rest of the work that all the rest of you do, whether it's what you do professionally or at home or your day off. That means that all of life, let's just say it this way, all of life is spiritual. See, the whole idea that there is this sacred and then there's this secular, that's totally bogus. That's messed up. Like the idea that going to church and praying and reading your Bibles and telling others about who Jesus is, that that's spiritual, and then all the rest of stuff in life, well, that's just secular. It doesn't really matter. Now, those things that I just described, that's a small part of our daily lives, isn't it? I mean, that's just a little slice of the pie, right? And that concept is bogus. It is completely opposite of being who we are created to be, living idols, being God's good and loving presence. The truth is, all of life is spiritual. So going to the store, shopping, playing games with the kids, doing homework, calling on the phone, walking your dog, going for a run, reading a good book, having a beer when you get home from work, watching a movie, eating a burrito, and the great percentage of time that you spend selling real estate or managing employees or working with your hands that you do all day long, along with all the other work of your home and life and family activities are spiritual. There's no distinction. That idea comes from Greek philosophy that was around generations or even centuries before the church ever began. Over time, it worked its way into the church. But it's not in the Bible. See, some people think of themselves as a follower of Christ when they go to, quote, church on Sunday, and then when they leave, it's just totally different. That is wrong. All of life is all in Jesus. There are no compartments with God. So how are your children and grandchildren and friends and neighbor and community going to catch that? Only if that's true of you. See, most likely our future generations will catch that or not, because how we live our lives in regard to our true identity and who we are in Christ. Now listen, the only spiritual distinction in the Bible is between those who are spiritual and those who are not, between those who are in the flesh and those who are in the spirit, the distinction between those who are in Christ and those who are not, between those who are spiritually dead or the living dead that's pictured in the Bible and those who have come alive by God's Spirit and become spiritual again. In your notes, I have a couple of scriptures. The first is in Corinthians, and let's just read. The apostle writes, "We speak with those taught by the Spirit, explaining spiritual things to spiritual people." You may want to underline that. "The unbeliever does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually discerned." You see, that is the only spiritual distinction in the world right there. And let's notice something really, really important. When we come to Jesus Christ as our Lord and as our Savior, there is a dramatic change that takes place. We become spiritual, those who are alive from the living dead. And what this is saying in the context, in the story of the scripture, that we are restored to our original vocation, our purpose, our meaning, our work. We have become living idols once again, spiritually alive with the presence of God once again. Let's also read this from Romans in your notes. "One man sinned, and so death ruled all people because of that one man." That's this present age. "But now those people who accept God's full grace and the great gift of being made right with him will surely have true life and rule through the one man, Jesus Christ." I would underline that. True life and rule through the one man. Do you get how that is connecting what Paul is saying? In turning and giving our allegiance to follow Jesus as King, we are restored to our vocation. We are rulers once again. Now, for right now, and there's a place you can write what I just said there in your notes, for right now, it's incognito. But it will one day be revealed. That's what the scriptures are talking about when they talk about the day of the revelation of Jesus Christ and us being revealed with him as kings and queens. That's what it's talking about. Now, we are incognito right now, but being restored and being living idols, that's our identity. That is our purpose. And that is the way that we are to conduct ourselves right now in a world that is broken in this broken age. Now, if we are going to unfold future generations and teach them and build them up to be kings and queens, our children have to get this. How are we going to do that? That is a question we must answer. The home and the family exist to cultivate and create kings and queens who animate the presence of the Lord in all of life. The church exists to cultivate and create kings and queens who animate the presence of the Lord in all of life, all over the world. Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you for telling us what is really going on and opening our eyes to who you have made us to be and how unique and truly different we are in you, Jesus, how we are spiritual, made new, alive, to animate and embody your presence in all of life for you and with you, with us. And thank you that we don't have to search for meaning, or that we don't have to make up meaning, because we have meaning inherent in us, in you, who have originally made us and then now restored us to who you have for us to be in our salvation in you. And help us to see that this is a big part of our salvation, that we have come alive spiritually and we are restored in our vocation in you, as those who once again animate and embody your presence in all the various kinds of work that we do, serving others and in contributing to society, making something of our world as we serve and as we worship you. And Lord, please help us to consider deeply and to pray about and to seek you to help us to take hold of these four need-to-know truths. Help us to grasp and grab hold with both hands why the home and the family exist, and what our job and purpose is as parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and friends. Help us to consider what actions we will take, what we're going to do to embrace our true identity, and how we're going to unfold our future generations and teach them and build them up to be kings and queens. We pray this in you, Jesus, as your restored co-workers and co-rulers. Empower us. Give us wisdom by your Spirit. Amen.
Yeah.
thank you once again for your goodness, God, and your constant love and affection, God, and that you are our friend, God, along with our father and our strength and our hope, God. You have so many names and so many ways and so many reasons to praise you, God. And right now we just recognize that and we lift up these prayers to you and this worship to you right now, God. We pray that you work through us and that you continue to edify us and grow us to be who you want us to be and to rely on yourself instead of ours. Lord, we love you and we praise you, and in your name, amen.